Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjali Ammal Mahalingam Engineering College. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on Engineering Thermodynamics. We are discussing the Module 10, Psychrometric Properties and Processes. So, the topic is Psychrometric Processes and Properties and Processes. And this is lecture number 2 on the Module number 10. We recap from the previous lecture, first lecture on the psychrometrics. So, we discussed the psychrometric properties and we studied about the psychrometric chart. So, using the psychrometric chart, you can find out the psychrometric properties. And in this lecture, so we will be discussing about the various psychrometric processes that are involved in the air conditioning calculations. The learning outcome for this lecture, at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to explain various psychrometric processes and the student will be able to write the equations to calculate the heat transfer, water vapor addition or removal in a psychrometric process. So, look at the diagram. So, this is the skeleton of the psychrometric chart. X-axis we have the dry bulb temperature, y-axis we have the specific humidity. The lines, various lines indicates various psychrometric processes. The process cooling. So, when the dry bulb temperature decreases at a constant specific humidity, that is called as cooling. And this is heating, horizontal line heating. The dry bulb temperature increases at constant specific humidity is called as heating. You have a vertical line where the specific humidity, vertically upward line, specific humidity increases at constant dry bulb temperature. That is humidification or humidifying, and the reverse, decreasing the specific humidity at constant dry bulb temperature is called as dehumidifying. And the combination, so this is heating and humidification, this is one process, heating and humidification, and this is another process, cooling and dehumidification, combination of cooling and dehumidification, this is combination of heating and humidification. So, we will be studying about various psychrometric processes in this lecture, and this is the skeleton of the psychrometric chart what we are going to use for all our calculations. And what is a psychrometric process? The processes affecting the psychrometric properties of air are called as psychrometric processes. So, what are all the psychrometric properties? Specific humidity, dry bulb temperature, wet bulb temperature, relative humidity, degree of saturation, all these are properties, psychrometric properties. So, by a process, when these properties are affected or changed, then it is called a psychrometric process. The processes involve mixing of air stream, heating, cooling, humidifying, dehumidifying, adiabatic saturation, and mostly the combination of all these processes. So, we have no separate heating. There will be heating and humidification, cooling and dehumidification. So, the combination of process will be happening in any air conditioning device. So, the various processes that we are going to discuss in this lecture, sensible heating and sensible cooling, cooling and dehumidification, heating and humidification, chemical dehumidification, evaporative cooling, and the mixing of air streams. So, the first process, sensible heating or cooling. So, heating or cooling, sensible heating or cooling of air water vapor mixer without change in the specific humidity. That is what the humidification. So, look at the diagram, various diagrams. So, this is a duct in which the air is flowing, the air and water vapor mixture is flowing. M1 is the quantity of moisture entering in the left side, G1 is the quantity of mass of the air, H1 is the enthalpy of the air and water vapor mixture, W1 is the specific humidity of the air and water vapor mixture, T1 is the temperature, and the Q12 is the amount of heat added. So, it is leaving. M2 is the moisture, mass of the moisture, G2 is the mass of the air, W2 is the specific humidity and T2 is the temperature at the outlet. Now, look at the psychrometric chart. So in the skeleton of the psychrometric chart, the process is indicated. You have a horizontal line. So that means the dry bulb temperature is changing from T1 to T2. The specific humidity remains constant. So other properties are changing. Say for example, relative humidity is changing, enthalpy is changing. So the specific humidity is constant for change in the increase in the temperature, increase in the dry bulb temperature. And similarly, the temperature entropy diagram is indicating the process. 1 to 2 is the process, sensible heating. The reverse of the process is called a sensible cooling. So when the temperature decreases at the constant specific humidity, then it is called as sensible cooling. So sensible heating is the process in which dry bulb temperature increases and the specific humidity remains constant. So we have to write the energy balance for air, G1 equal to G2, there is no change in the air quantity, moisture, M1 equal to M2, there is no change in the moisture quantity or water vapor quantity. So from the definition of specific humidity W1 equal to M1 by G1 and W2 equal to M2 by G2. So we write M1 equal to G1 W1, this equal to G2 W2. So W1 W2, they are the specific humidity of the air at the inlet and the outlet. Then we write the energy balance. So the air enters with the enthalpy H1. We are adding the heat energy Q12, that is equal to the air is leaving with the enthalpy H2. So G1 H1 plus Q12 equal to G2 H2. So dividing by G, the amount of heat added Q12 equal to G into H2 minus H1. So this is the heat transfer during this process, during the heating process. So Q12 equal to G into H2 minus H1. And we substitute H2 equal to HCA2 plus W2 HW2 and H1 equal to HCA1 plus W1 HW1. So W2 is the specific humidity at the outlet, W1 is the specific humidity at the inlet, HW1 is the enthalpy of the water vapor in the air, and HW2 is the enthalpy of the water vapor in the air. HCA1, HCA2 they are the enthalpy of air. So this is the final equation. So using this equation, you can calculate the amount of heat transfer during this process. And for Cp is specific heat of the steam, W1 equal to W2, HG2 equal to HG1, dry bulb temperature, dew point temperature 1 equal to dew point temperature 2. So the final equation Q12 equal to G into Cpa into T2 minus T1 plus Cp into W into T2 minus T1, or G into Cpa is 1.005 T2 minus T1 and Cp of the water vapor is taken as 1.9 W into T2 minus T1. So similar expression may be obtained for cooling process with the constant specific humidity. So the same equation, but the heat transfer will be negative. If you use the same equation, the heat transfer will be negative. That is the difference. And in the, so you look at the diagram. Once again, we take the diagram here. So we have a heating coil, we have some coil for heating purpose. The coil surface temperature is, we take T3. The coil surface temperature is T3. Now, there is one parameter. During this process, the specific humidity remains constant, but the dry bulb temperature rises and approaches that of the surface of the heater. Surface temperature of the heater. So there is a heater available to increase the temperature of the air. The surface temperature of the heater, we take T3. So what is the maximum outlet temperature possible for the air? That is equal to the surface temperature of the heater. So the extent to which it approaches the mean effective surface temperature of the coil is conveniently expressed by the term called bypass factor. So we define a bypass factor. So in the case of sensible heating or sensible cooling. So the bypass for sensible heating, the bypass factor for the heating process defined as the ratio of difference between the mean surface temperature of the coil and leaving air temperature to the difference between mean surface temperature and the entering air temperature. So for sensible heating, bypass factor equal to T3 minus T2 divided by T3 minus T1. For sensible cooling, bypass factor equal to T2 minus T3 divided by T1 minus T3. So because the for cooling purpose, the cooling coil surface temperature will be lower than the air temperature, where T3 is the surface temperature of the heating or the cooling coil. And this parameter bypass factor is important for solving problems in the sensible heating or cooling process. So, next process is cooling and dehumidification process. So, you look at the diagram. So, it is reducing temperature as well as dehumidifying, that is removing the water vapor. So, we have to reduce the temperature as well as reduce the amount of water vapor present in the air. So, look at the diagram. We have a duct. So, in the duct, we have the evaporator coil of the refrigeration system. So, for this process, we have the refrigerant system. So, this is the evaporator coil and the expansion valve, condenser and the compressor. So, the air from the compressor, high pressure, the refrigerant is flowing through the condenser where it loses the temperature, then the expansion valve where the pressure is reduced. So, the low pressure, low temperature refrigerant is circulated through the evaporator. And the evaporator is here inside the coil, we circulate the refrigerant which is at very low temperature, and it absorbs the heat energy of the air. So, by absorbing the heat energy, the temperature of the air decreases, and the water, because of the temperature, the water vapor getting condensed and the condensate is collected in the tray here. Then when it absorbs the heat energy, it becomes hot. Then the vapor, it goes to the compressor. So, this is the refrigeration cycle, and this evaporator coil of the refrigeration cycle is used for this purpose, cooling and dehumidification. The terminologies are the same. G1 is the mass of the air at inlet, and G2 is the mass of the air at the outlet, and M1 is the mass of the water vapor at the inlet, M2 is the mass of the water vapor at the outlet. Similarly, specific humidity W, enthalpy H, and temperature T. Now, look at the diagram, the psychrometric chart. So, this is the process 1 and this is process 2. So, the process cooling and dehumidification. Because of the cooling, dry bulb temperature decreases. Because of the dehumidification, the specific humidity decreases. So, look at the diagram here. So, the temperature, so from here, it is the temperature is decreasing and the specific humidity is also decreasing. Now, how to achieve this process, the cooling and dehumidification. So, it is by cooling and then dehumidification and then heating. So, there are, when you solve the problem, you can understand, you cannot directly, when you use the psychrometric chart, you can directly connect these two points and find out all the properties and calculate the amount of water vapor removed and the amount of heat added for the raising the temperature that we can calculate. So, for calculation purpose, for mass balance for air, G1 equal to G2, for mass of water vapor removed. So, M1 equal to M2 plus L. Actually, M1 is the mass of the water vapor entering here. Because of the condensation, removal of the water vapor, a certain quantity of water vapor is removed, that is L, and remaining is flowing here. So, M1 equal to M2 plus L. So, the mass of water vapor removed equal to M1 minus M2. Which is equal to G into W1 minus W2. And energy balance, G1 H1 equal to G2 H2 plus Q12 plus L into HF2. L is the amount of moisture removed and HF2 is the enthalpy of the moisture. So, substituting Q12 equal to G into H1 minus H2 minus W1 minus W2 into HF2. So, HF2 is the specific enthalpy of the water at the temperature T2. So, the cooling and dehumidification process is used in the summer air conditioning system. So, in the summer time, so the air conditioner is operating with the cooling and dehumidification because the surrounding temperature is very high. So, we have to reduce the temperature. When you reduce the temperature, the moisture water vapor quantity will increase. The quantity is to be removed. So, cooling and dehumidification is used in the summer air conditioning system. And so look at here. So 1 to 4 is the cooling and dehumidification process. So how this is achieved? 1 to 2 it is cooling, sensible cooling, and 2 to 3 it is saturation. Then again it is 3 to 4. So sometimes from here we can move heating process. So cooling, adiabatic saturation process, then it is heating process. Then here we have a coil, evaporator coil, and the surface temperature of the coil is called as apparent dew point temperature. So the surface temperature is called as apparent dew point temperature T3, and here again we define the bypass factor. So bypass factor equal to T3 minus T2 divided by T3 minus T1. So T2 is the inlet temperature, T2 is the outlet temperature, and T3 is the ADP, apparent dew point temperature. Heating and humidification process. So look at here. So a duct is there. So we have a heating coil, and then we have a water spray. So in the air is with all the properties. G1 is the quantity of air, M1 is the mass of the water vapor, H1 is the enthalpy of the mixer, W1 is specific humidity, T1 is the temperature, and the corresponding value at the outlet G2, M2, H2, W2 and T2. Now here we are heating. Because of the heating, the water vapor in the air, it is getting heated. So the water vapor, quantity of water vapor decreases. To compensate, we are adding the water vapor. So heating and humidification. And it is reverse of the previous process. Previous process is cooling and dehumidification. Now it is just opposite, heating and humidification. So look at this. This is the line 1 to 2. So T1 is the temperature here, T2 is the temperature here, W1 is the specific humidity here, W2 is the specific humidity at the point 2. So in the heating and dehumidification, the temperature of the air increases and the amount of water vapor is also increasing. So enthalpy is increasing. That is the heating and humidification process. So you write the mass balance for air, G1 equal to G2. Mass of water vapor added. So M1 plus L equal to M2. So L equal to M2 minus M1. So which is G into W2 minus W1. And the energy balance, G1 H1 plus L into HF plus Q12 equal to G2 H2. So the amount of heat added equal to G into H2 minus H1 minus L into HF. And this process is used in the winter air conditioning system. Heating and humidification is used in the winter air conditioning system. Adiabatic mixing. So where do you find the adiabatic? So summer air conditioner, winter air conditioner, we are familiar. So in a air conditioner, we have all the devices. So depending on the temperature setting and humidity setting, the particular device will work, whether this is humidification, dehumidification, heating or cooling, depending on the setting. So the process will occur. But what is the significance of this adiabatic mixing of two streams, air streams? We assume there is an air conditioned room. So in the air conditioned room, we have air at a particular atmosphere, particular setting. So for example, we fix the temperature at a particular temperature, 24 degrees Celsius and 70% relative humidity. So that is the condition of the air inside the room. The surrounding temperature, outside temperature is, we say outside the temperature, air temperature is 30 degrees Celsius and humidity is 60% or 80%. When somebody open the door of the air conditioned room, so there is a mixing of atmospheric air will rush into the room, or the air from the room will go out through the opening. So now there is mixing of atmospheric air with the air inside the air conditioned room. So now the fresh air with the higher temperature is entering into the room. So after some time, the system will stabilize. So the mixing, so when you open the door, there is a mixing of atmospheric air with the air conditioned room. So when there is mixing, how the properties are getting affected? That is what the discussion here. So adiabatic mixing of two streams. So here look at here, point 1, G1, W1, H1. G1 is the quantity of air, W1 is the specific humidity, H1 is the enthalpy. G2, H2, W2. So G2 is the quantity of air, H2 is the enthalpy, and W2 is the specific humidity. And these two streams are mixing here and it is flowing. Now the air quantity is G3, enthalpy is H3, and the specific humidity is W3. So the process is explained here. So one is the condition W1, T1, two is the condition W2, T2, and it is getting mixed, and the properties are now T3 and the W3, and the enthalpy is H3. Now for mass balance, G1 plus G2 equal to G3. For vapor, M1 plus M2 equal to M3. So G1 W1 plus G2 W2 equal to G3 W3. And the energy balance, G1 H1 plus G2 H2 equal to G3 H3. So combining these two equations. So this is the first equation. Use this equation. G1 W1 plus G2 W2 equal to G3 W3. And G1 H1 plus G2 H2 plus equal to G3 H3. Using these two equations. So G1 by G2 equal to H3 minus H2 divided by H1 minus H3. Which is equal to W3 minus W2 divided by W1 minus W3. So this equation we have to remember for solving the problem in the mixing of the air steam in the cyclometric process. And the chemical dehumidification. So dehumidification is removal of water vapor from the air. In the earlier what we discussed dehumidification, we have a evaporator coil. We require a refrigeration system for dehumidification process. But sometimes we can use the chemicals for removal. So the main chemical is silica gel. Some substance like silica gel and activated alumina have a great affinity to water vapor. So they are called as adsorbents. So when air passes through the bed of silica gel, water vapor molecule heat absorbed on its surface. Latent heat of condensation release. So the driver temperature of the air increases. So when the air and water vapor mixer, it is flowing through a bed of adsorbents, the dehumidification, it absorbs the water vapor, dehumidification process taking place. How to recognize the chemical dehumidification? So when you purchase any electronic gadgets, so for example, computer, TV, everything, they put inside the packing a small packet with a small white color balls, that they are the silica gel adsorbent. Why they are having that? It is actually the atmospheric air contains some amount of water vapor. The water vapor is to be removed, and you have to maintain the condition for the safety of the electronic product. So that is why we have a packet of adsorbent silica gel in any electronic packing. Then evaporative cooling process. So this is actually evaporative cooling. The cooling done by evaporation of water. So actually this is the process. So we have an insulated duct where the air is flowing and the water is sprayed here, and by evaporating water we are cooling the air. What is the best example for evaporative cooling? Mud pot. When you store water in a mud pot, you may find always a layer of water on the outside surface of the mud pot. It is because of through the micron level holes in the mud pot, the water leaks to the outer surface, and the layer of water available on the outer surface, it is getting evaporated. And in a summer time, so you have some amount of water in the mud pot and place it in the atmospheric condition. So after some time, you may find that the water temperature inside the mud pot will be lower than the initial temperature. So there is, even in the hot summer season, the water inside the mud pot, it is cooled. How this is possible? It is because of the evaporative cooling technique. So in a mud pot, so always there is a layer of outside layer of water in the mud pot. That layer is getting evaporated. For the evaporation of that water, it takes the heat from the water. So that is why the water inside the pot is getting cooled. That is what evaporative cooling. And this evaporative cooling, the water is sprayed in the duct where the air water vapor mix is circulated. Utilizing the temperature of the air water vapor mixer, some of the water is evaporated, and the specific humidity of the air water vapor mixer increases and the driver temperature decreases. So the cooling is achieved by evaporation of the water being sprayed. So here mass balance for air, G1 equal to G2 equal to G. For water, G1 W1 plus L equal to G2 W2. The energy balance is G1 H1 plus L into HF equal to G2 H2. So G into H1 minus H2 plus G into W2 minus W1 plus HF into HF equal to 0. So writing the balance equation, H1 minus W1 HF equal to H2 minus W2 HF. That is what the energy balance. And the evaporative cooling technique, it is used in the cooling tower. So in all the steam power plant, you may find a cooling tower. So the cooling tower is used for cooling hot water using the atmospheric air. In the condenser, we are circulating water. The hot water coming out of the condenser is cooled by the cooling tower. So the hot water, warm water is entering at the top. So we have some arrangement for spraying the warm water. So the warm water is flowing downward. At the same time, using some mechanical system or naturally, the atmospheric air enters at the bottom, and using some fan, we can circulate the air from the bottom to the top. So the water particle, as the water is sprayed from the top, the water particles are moving downward and the air is flowing in the upward direction. And there is a contact between air and the water vapor, and the water vapor, it is cooled by evaporation technique. So what is the evaporation technique? So the water vapor particle, always normally it is in the spherical shape. Normally it is in the spherical shape. The outer layer of the spherical water particle, it is evaporated, and using the air temperature, that water particle vapor is removed. And the air water is cooled, and the cooled water is collected at the bottom. So water is sprayed using the evaporative technique. So the cooling of water is happening in the case of cooling tower. And this is the some better layout of the cooling tower. We have a fan. The warm water is sprayed here. So the atmospheric air enters here. It is moving in the upward direction, and we collect the water at the bottom. And then it is being recirculated again to the condenser. So this is the better layout of a cooling tower. So here for energy balance and mass balance for air, G1 equal to G2 equal to G. For water, G1 W1 plus MW3 equal to G2 W2 plus MW4. So MW3 minus MW4 equal to G into W2 minus W1. And the energy balance is G1 H1 plus MW3 H3 equal to G2 H2 plus MW4 H4. So G into H1 minus H2 plus MW3 H3, HW3 equal to MW4 HW4. So the approach, there is one parameter in the cooling tower design, cooling tower calculation, the approach temperature, the wet bulb temperature of the entering air minus temperature of the cooled water, that is what the approach equal to TW3 minus TWB, wet bulb temperature 1. That is what the approach. So we stop here. So these are all the psychrometric processes which are all important for all our calculation, particularly sensible heating, cooling, dehumidification, heating and humidification, and mixing of adiabatic steam. So in the four processes, we will be solving problems. And we have a reflection spot here. So from the your observation for the past 25 minutes for observation, you just name the psychrometric processes. Recall your memory and take a pen and write down the psychrometric processes which you remember. You take few seconds time. So if you are able to write all these processes, then it is correct. So sensible heating and sensible cooling, cooling and dehumidification, heating and dehumidification, heating and humidification, chemical dehumidification, evaporative cooling, mixing of gas steam. So these are all the processes. And these are all the reference books I used for preparing the slides. You can also refer to it for additional information. And you subscribe the channel. So that I will give all the update for the updated videos will be available for you. And you can write to my mail ID for any queries. Thank you for watching, and we'll meet again in the next lecture. We will solve problems on the psychrometric processes and properties.